Today we will discuss about the first module of the design of machine elements. To start with, we will define what is the meaning of design. To design is to formulate a plan for the satisfaction of a human need, or it is a process to solve a specific problem. Now in this definition, we have used highlighted two words. One is formulate, it means to create, generate, etc. Another one is a plan, an idea of how to do something. So design engineers do not actually manufacture a component. Basically, they create a plan which can solve a particular problem. So if there is any problem and we need a solution for this, so the design engineers will create a plan, an idea in the form of a document or a diagram or a set of processes, so that using this plan, one can actually solve the problem. So therefore, to design is to formulate a plan for the satisfaction of a human need. That is the first definition of design. Now, this design definition is valid for most aspects of human life. You can use this in every walk of the life. However, we can go to the second definition called engineering design. Engineering design can be defined as a process of applying science and engineering methods to prescribe a component or a system in sufficient detail to permit its realization. So here we are restricting our design process to engineering only. So the moment we say engineering, we are using a science and engineering techniques. Okay, using these techniques, we are creating a plan about a system, about a plan. When somebody uses this plan, he will be able to actually create that. So that is, we are given enough details. Every possible details is given in this plan, so that the user of this plan, we can create the particular system or a component that has been designed by a design engineer. The design process has got some features. The first one being, it is innovative and highly iterative process. So unlike the other aspects of engineering, where you got a particular problem and use some mathematics and solve and get the answer. Here it is innovative. So most of the time you don't have an answer. There is no fixed answer. So you just have to use your common sense and try various options and arrive at the correct solution. So therefore it is innovative and is highly iterative. Iterative means you just do trial and error and then do it again and again until you get the correct solution. Now, design making with little or enough information. So often, we have enough information to smoothly design a particular component or a system. Or it is also possible in some situations, you may not even have enough information to design the particular system. In that case, you have to do your own research and own creative thinking is to be used to arrive at a solution. So of course, in the next point, it of course needs a technical skills. The basic mathematics and engineering aspects are required. And design is a very communication intensive activity. So what do we mean by communication intensive activity? Means the design engineer should be competent enough to communicate in all possible modes of communication. For example, verbal, pictorial. So you should know how to write it, how to communicate it so that other person can understand. And another important aspect of design is there is no unique answer. So each person can design get a different solutions for a particular problem. So which solution is better is dependent on the user. Some users may prefer this design, some user may prefer another design. So it, of course, it may even subject to market play. Whoever wins in the market will finally win the particular design will win in the market. This is about general engineering design. So again, a subset of that is, this is mechanical engineering design, where we are restricting the entire engineering design process to mechanical engineering only. Therefore, we are saying it is a design of things which are mechanical in nature. That means all the branches of mechanical engineering are involved in this, be it material, fluids, machines, etc. So of course, and this is somewhat similar to another definition called machine. We are designing only mechanical systems. Machines in particular, then we call it as machine design. So it's a design of machines or mechanical systems to perform a specific function with maximum efficiency, and the machine involves designing the elements and arranging them optimally to obtain some use. Though there are different types of design, especially the machine design types are One is adaptive design. Adaptive basically means there is already a design. You are just modifying it to your requirement. So for example, design of conveyor belt. So it's already available. The entire design process is available. You just have to pick what dimension is suitable for your particular industry. So this is adaptive design. So there is a developmental design. That means the design is not fixed one. It increases incrementally. So here you do some modification to the design that is already there. So unlike the first case where in adaptive design, you don't really use much of your brain. You just simply use the existing design and use it for your application. Whereas in developmental design, you try to improve its efficiency. So you want to enhance its performance, or maybe you want to reduce the cost of the machine. So, and for example, there is a change in a market condition. Let's say the car that you have designed has got more weight, and hence it's becoming very costly. So somehow you want to reduce the weight of the car. So when you are doing such incremental changes, after so many changes, the existing model will become a new model. So example, a new model of a car. So when a company releases a car, it is coming with certain features. But later on, over the period of time, they will improve upon and make a new model. So that's the developmental design process. Most of the industries are involved in this developmental design. Now the third one is new design. New design is an entirely new one. So there is no pre-existing design available. Here it's the problem is unique and you have to come out with a unique solution. So though it may not be a completely new scientific invention, but it still needs a creative thinking to solve a particular problem. You may have to do some research, look into the market survey, you get some technical literature and talk to the people and see if somebody has got similar ideas. So combining all this, you will create a product which was never existing. So then it becomes a new design. Now we will study the phases of design, also called stages in the design process. There are different stages given by different authors. So we'll follow what is the process suggested by the Shigle. The first one is identification of need, okay, followed by the definition of the problem, and then synthesis, analysis and optimization, evaluation, and finally presentation. So as you can see from this diagram, if everything goes well, one follows the other. So after identification, you go to definition of problem and then go to synthesis. But this won't happen in reality. Many times you may have to go back and go to the previous step and redo it again. For example, in this diagram, you can see. So from here, you're going from analysis and optimization, you're going back to the synthesis. You found that in the analysis, it is that particular design is not working as per your need, then you may have to resynthesize it. You can redo it again. Okay. Sometimes even in the synthesis step itself, you may not get the required output as planned. Then you have to go back and define the problem once again. You have to redefine the need also. So there are many such iterative steps. Then you may have to go back, do the trial and error, and then come back. So therefore, the design steps are not sequential. They are iterative in nature. The first one is recognition of the need. So the starting procedure of a design is somebody should identify that there is a need to do something. So when there is a need, only then the design process starts. So recognition of need involves the realization by someone that a problem exists for which a solution is to be found. So somebody has designed that it has decided that there is a problem and that a solution is to be found out. So that is the first step of design. This design, the recognition of the need, that there is a need, may not always be clear. Sometimes it is very clear. Okay, I have a problem with this. There is this particular machine, this thing is vibrating a lot and I need to reduce its vibration. So that is clear cut need. So need is very well defined here. In some cases, the need may not be well defined. We know there is some problem with this machine, so something is not right. You will get a sense or a feel that something is not right, but you still don't know what exactly has happened to the machine, what exactly is the problem. So sometimes you have to use your innovative thinking to clearly identify the need. Okay, then the next step is definition of the problem. It involves a thorough specification of the item to be designed. The specification generally includes the functional and physical characteristics such as input and output, cost, quality, performance, etc. So it can also be what is the size of the machine, what it does, what is the input to this machine, what it gives, what is the cost of manufacturing this machine, and what is the quality of the output you get from this. All these have to be put it in a paper and should be very clearly specified. So it's not just enough to say something is wrong. Here you have to identify what is wrong. It's very vague, whereas the definition of the problem, you are clearly defining the problem. For example, somebody may say the air is not clear, so that is a need. Of course, you need a cleaner air is a need to reduce the dust or the pollution from the power plant. You have to reduce the pollution from the automobiles. All this could be a restating the problem so that the problem becomes more specific. So that is about definition of the problem. And the third step is a synthesis. Here, unlike the previous two steps, you are actually trying to propose a solution, not one solution, many solutions. Okay. Synthesis phase involves suggesting various preliminary ideas developed through research of similar product or design in use. So you may take a product which is already there and suggest some modifications and then propose a solution. Not one, many solutions are proposed in this. So synthesis is a proposal stage where you propose various possible ways of doing the same thing. Once the proposals are ready, once you have suggested how a particular thing is to be done, then we go for the analysis and optimization steps. Analysis basically means using mathematical skills to analyze the required output of the problem, how it functions, and whether the design specifications are met or not. Though that is, preliminary designs are then subjected to analysis to find their suitability for the given design specification. So in the previous step, somebody has suggested a particular design and you calculated its, let us say, strength. You found that strength is not sufficient. Then that's a failed design. So you don't want to use that particular design. So the process to, you know, use the mathematical techniques to identify whether the required specifications are not met or not is the analysis. So now out of the 100 solutions suggested in the previous step, you may found out that around 50 solutions are useful. In the sense, you are designing a motor which can produce a power of, let us say, 100 kilowatt. So all this out of the 100, 50 solutions give you around 50 kilowatt of power. But then all these solutions may not be efficient. So what you have to do is, among these remaining 50 which actually work, you have to identify those things which are effective, which are optimized. In the sense, it should give the solution with least cost and with least material involved, and the quality should also be better. So when you analyze the existing solutions for the, you know, to identify the best solution, that procedure is called optimization. So that's the reason why it's a iterative process. So this iterative process is repeated until the proposed design meets the specification, or until the design is convinced that the design is feasible. Sometimes it may so happen in the synthesis, somebody has suggested 100 solutions and all the 100 solutions are not working. In that case, again, you have to go back to the recognition of need and definition of the problem and rework once again with the synthesis. That's how the design process is a iterative process. So once you are satisfied this, okay, all the solutions are, all the required outputs are obtained, and then it is also optimal solution, then you go to the evaluation. This step often involves fabrication and testing of a prototype model to evaluate operating performance. So let's say you have designed a machine in a computer or in the pen and paper mode. All the dimensions are specified, you have calculated that it gives the required output and required strength, and then finally you actually have to evaluate. Evaluation means you actually fabricate or create a machine in reality using the materials and all the procedures discussed above. You have a prototype model, and then this has to be tested to all your requirement. For example, I wanted its weight to be below certain kgs, or I want its speed of that machine to be so and so. So when you actually do it, and if your all requirements are met, then you say your design is successful, and it won't happen for the first time in most of the cases. So you may found out that the speed is working perfectly, it's giving all the speeds, all the power, but somehow you found that it is giving a lot of vibrations. So then you have to again go back to the previous steps. You have to go for one more synthesis step, and then out analyze and optimize and come back again, evaluate. So therefore, evaluation is a final test, in the sense you are satisfied that it actually works. Okay. So once you are satisfied with the evaluation, then you go for the final presentation. Presentation is giving your solution, you're giving your plan in a way that other people can understand. As a design engineer, you may have to give this entire design in the form of a document. It could be a 2D or 3D drawing with all the bill of materials, that is what the material to be used. Should contain every minor detail so that the person who is actually looking into this should be convinced that it's actually a workable model. Okay, and you may have to really behave like a salesman. You have to be advocate of your product. You have to convince the other guy that your design is the best design and that he should be ready to manufacture, because it is said many good designs have died in the past because the designer was unable to convince the guy who is actually manufacturing it or actually who is going to produce that. So it is important that an engineer not only is good in mathematics and other engineering skills, he should also be able to convince the other person who is willing to buy the design. Therefore, the design engineer has to be very good in communication. It could be oral or it could be a written or in other modes of communications. So therefore, the communication is an important step for the design engineer. Now we will see the design considerations. So these are the points or the parameters or the issues that have to be considered while designing. The first one is functionality. So your design should also look into the factor known as functionality. What is the functionality of that particular machine is, and then your stress or strength, distortion or deflection, that is what is the maximum strength the component is likely to have, and whether that deflection, what is the maximum deflection allowed, what is the stiffness allowed in the particular situation has to be considered, and is there a where is an important factor or not, that will decide the kind of design you are going to do it. So, and also the corrosion, if the machine is going to work in a corrosive environment, then you should also take care that there is no corrosion. So accordingly, the design has to be changed. And safety and reliability. Safety basically means it depends on how much factor of safety you are giving in your design. If it is a design of a missile, the factor of safety may be very less, because anyway it's going to be destroyed. If you are designing, say, a bridge, then the factor of safety is very important, because the life of human is involved. So accordingly, the safety is an important parameter which will decide the factor of safety. And reliability is what is the confidence with which you say this particular design is working, and what are the costs involved if the design fails. All that has to be considered in reliability aspects. Manufacturability means your design looks very beautiful, but then you are not able to manufacture it, or if you are able to manufacture but with a lot of cost and trouble, then the design is a failure. So you must design in a way that is easy to manufacture. And next one is utility. I mean, it should serve some purpose, it should have some utility. And then of course cost is an important factor. A very good design but very costly will not be sold in the market, and it's useless. So cost is an important consideration while designing. And then friction, weight, in the sense whether friction is involved during the operation. If so, what happens to the life of the component is also to be taken care of. And weight, whether what is the maximum weight allowed. The design may be good and weight may be very large, in that case also it's a failure. So it is also an important factor. And the life of the design or a component that you're going to design. Some things are designed for a short life, maybe some 3 to 4 years, or some are designed for 20 to 30 years. Noise is important, in the sense where this particular machine is going to be used. If it is in an important residential area, the noise that is generated from your machine may create a problem and they may not use it. Therefore, noise is an important criteria. Maybe it is used in a desert area, that's okay. Noise may not be an important factor there. So therefore, where it is used, whether it is giving required noise that is below the regulated level, all that has to be considered. Styling, shape and size, of course, a good design, it has all the functionality, it has good utility, strength, everything is fine, but it is doesn't look good, then also people may not buy. So therefore, style, shape and size are very important in the design. And you may have whether any control is required for this particular machine, and is also an important criteria. And these thermal properties like conductivity, coefficient of thermal expansion, thus all things, these things have to be considered, because if something is operating in high temperature region and it may deform and it may make the design a failure. So therefore, thermal properties are also important, and also the surface of the machine, whether you want a smooth surface or rough surface, or will it lead to any fracture based on the rough surface, all that has to be considered. When is the lubrication, any component involves relative motion in which lubrication is required, that has to be considered. And of course, marketability is a very important thing. So whether you are able to sell that product or not is an important. If not able to market it, then the whole everything is fine, but it's not marketable, it's a useless product. So, and whether maintenance is an important criteria, because many a times the sale of a particular machine also is governed by how much maintenance is required. So whether your design needs more maintenance or less maintenance is also an important factor. The volume, basically here, how many products of your design are going to be made. If it is a single piece, then the design aspect is different. If you are producing in a large numbers, if it's a mass production, then also your design has to be accordingly different. I mean, you should be able to quickly manufacture and give it to the market. Liability means it's legal issues involved. Sometimes if your design is failing, then you may also be put behind the bars. So say you are designing a pressure vessel, you have to ensure that you are following certain codes. According to that code, if you are designed, then you are safe. Otherwise, if you have not followed that particular code, that is government regulations, then if it is found that the material has failed, your component has failed, they'll verify and see whether you have followed the code. If the code is followed, if the regulation is followed, you are safe. Otherwise, there may be a liability on the guy who has designed it. Sometimes the remanufacturing or resource recovery, in the sense whether it is resellable, whether you can use part of that to remanufacture it or to put it in some other machine. So that is also an important consideration in the design. In engineering, we use different kinds of materials. It's been a general practice to classify these engineering materials into 6 categories. The first one is metals, most popularly used. And then we have ceramics. It could be silicon nitrides or zirconias. And then we have polymers, what are known as plastics. And then we have elastomers, also called as rubbers. For example, we have natural rubber, neoprene is a rubber, butyl rubber. And then we have glasses, silica glasses or soda glass, different types of glasses. And in addition to these 5 materials, there is also a combination of materials that is known as composites, also called as hybrids. Let's go and study them in detail. First is metal. Metals are the most commonly used materials. They have got highest Young's modulus, that is stiffness is very high, and they are usually ductile in nature. In the sense, you can easily deform them. And the conductivity, be it electrical or thermal, their conductivity is usually very high, and they are conducting materials. And many times it is possible to alloy them. You mix the other common like carbon, magnesium and other things, and you can change its properties. So alloying them can be done to strengthen its original material property. But one disadvantage with metals is they are generally weak against corrosion, so they can be corroded easily. And then we have ceramics. Ceramics also have got very high stiffness, and they are brittle, unlike the metal, which are, they got high strength but they are ductile, whereas ceramics have got high strength but they are brittle in nature. That means they don't deform much, they fail with little deformations, whereas in metals, while they are failing, you can actually see their dimension increasing, and you can guess that there is a there is going to be a failure. Whereas in case of ceramics, there is a little deformation and it is very difficult to find out whether it is failing or not. And like metals, they also have got very good strength. In fact, they are more stronger than metals. And there are some advantages of the ceramics. They got abrasion resistance and you cannot easily scratch the surfaces. They have very got rough surfaces. The outer layer of this material is very rough. Therefore, they are commonly used in bearing and cutting tools. And most popular application of ceramics is their high temperature applications, because they resist high temperature. They can sustain a large temperature. Therefore, they are usually used in turbine blades and in furnaces. And they are very good at resisting the corrosion. So that's why you see these toilets and basins, they are made of these ceramic materials, because whatever chemical you pour them, you cannot easily destroy them. So they are resistant to corrosion. And one negative point about this is they have got very low tolerance for stress concentration. That means if there is any small flaw, then they may lead to sudden failure, and they are very brittle in nature. So as long as the surface is smooth, that is fine. If there is any crack involved, any crack is formed, then they become very weak and they fail usually by brittle manner. And we all know about glasses, and these glasses are amorphous solids, non-crystalline, in the sense, unlike metals and ceramics, where the atoms are arranged in a particular fashion, there is an order. There could be BCC or HCC. Different orders are available for materials, whereas that kind of arrangement of atoms is not seen in case of glasses. And they are commonly used in bottles and oven wares. Like ceramic, these are hard, brittle, and vulnerable to stress concentration. So these are all the negative points of glass, because they can be easily broken, and they are good as long as the surface is smooth. And there is any crack, they can easily break into pieces. And the next one is polymers, commonly known as plastics. Plastics are they got very, very less Young's modulus. In fact, the stiffness is so less, that's almost 1/50th of whatever stiffness a metal, typical metal, has. And one good thing about plastics or polymers is they got low weight and they can be easily shaped, okay? And they are corrosion resistant also, in the sense they can take very strong chemicals and still they don't get destroyed. Therefore, they are commonly used as paint materials. But the negative point with respect to this material is they can work when the friction involved is very less and operating temperature is very less. For example, if plastic is used beyond 180 degree, it will degrade. It cannot take a temperature more than 200 degree. That means most of the plastics work below 100 degree temperature. So when the temperature increases, there will be degradation and all the properties will degrade. And also it is found these plastics, they creep at room temperature. That means that gradually there will be increase in dimensions, even though you have not applied any load, or at the time there will be increase in strain, or there will be relaxation in the stress in this material. So that's a negative point with polymers. Then we have elastomers, also called rubbers. As you know, rubbers are capable of enormous elastic extension, and their Young's modulus is very, very small. In fact, it is around 1/105th of a typical metal stiffness or Young's modulus. In addition to these five basic materials, we also have what are known as composites, also called as hybrids. These are combinations of two or more materials, and they are macroscopically combined. So individual properties add together in such a fashion that the combined composite property will be a better one than individual properties. And this can be tailored. You can make it strong, you can make it weak, you can make it corrosion resistance. Many properties, you can literally design a composite and get a particular properties. And these are the most popular properties right now, and the proper materials being used in industry.